This is probably one of the first neutralization reactions your students will explicitly meet. And certainly when it comes to ionic equations, we've just seen an example of the first one that they should be able to explain. But how do we know that the ions are there? Sure, you can add an indicator, but we first have to sell that this tells us about the concentration of hydrogen ions, and part of the charm of the way that indicators and pH work is that they respond in a logarithmic rather than a linear way as the reaction proceeds. One thing that does scale in a linear fashion, at least at lower concentrations, is the conductivity. I fine-tuned this demo specifically to show what happens to the ions in a neutralization reaction. And there are lots of tips along the way for getting the best possible results on any budget. So watch carefully and you'll see how to get beautiful results like this. Before we get going, let's clear up some linguistics. I recognize that it would be more correct to talk about the hydronium ion H3O+ than it would be to talk about H+ or protons floating around in solution. But, especially given the level that we're working at and that exam specifications and textbooks commonly use the same simplification, I hope everybody's cool with me just saying H+ for today. At least until next time, when we'll need a more subtle model to explain some of the effects that we'll see. What we want students paying attention to at this level is that acids are solutions containing hydrogen ions, okay, and alkaline solutions are those containing hydroxide ions. Specifically, when they write the formula for HCl, we want them to be able to visualize the ions dissociated into solution, not as molecules. So let's just reinforce that for a moment by hunting for ions with the Kleep's conductivity tester. Brought up with warnings of electrocution hazards, students will often instinctively feel like deionized water will conduct, but in reality, with an electricity as movement of charge model, it's not hard to see that while our water molecules can move, if they're neutral, we have no current. Meanwhile, in solutions of acids and alkalis, we have ions which, when they move through the solution, will be able to carry a charge, conducting electricity. But we have a problem with the other spectator ions in solution. Again, once we've got the basic setup working here, we can leave them in, but for now, let's use the reaction between barium hydroxide and sulfuric acid to take care of that issue. At this level, it's possible students will already know how a solution of barium ions can test for sulfate ions by forming the white barium sulfate precipitate. This removes those ions from solution, allowing us to focus just on the hydrogen and the hydroxide ions. I've used barium hydroxide octahydrate making up my solution. Now, the classic recipe for making up barium hydroxide solutions can be a bit of a faff due to its propensity for forming carbonates. But I found there's no need to go through the rigmarole of boiling water and using guard tubes for this reaction to work nicely. Any insoluble solid can be filtered off and you'll still get a solution close in concentration to the bench acids you have to hand, which, let's be honest, will themselves vary a little in their accuracy. Do be aware that depending on your situation, it's possible that the main use of barium hydroxide might be to show its endothermic reaction with ammonium salts. We've already covered this demo in a previous column, link below. As we'd already had a bottle that had been open for a while before the pandemic, making up a solution for me here now in late 2021 with that was a real problem initially. On the plus side, you do get to see with this reaction just how bad any old stock actually is, because cloudiness before you filter can make it seem like your hydroxide is a lot more carbonated than it actually is. We'll see that in our results later on. We use these squeezy dropper bottles holding about 100 ml of solution. They're fantastic for microscale work, but are large enough that you don't have to constantly refill them, which, if you use the tiny supplied funnels, is a bit of a nightmare. Shout out to Mark Cooper, my former technician, for finding these for us. Luckily, the Mattson-sized syringes that we use a lot recently can help us to load them up in a jiffy. I've left some solution out for about 20 minutes exposed to the air here, and this is what it looked like. Meanwhile, the dropper bottles without any guard tubes have lasted for well over a month so far with no signs of precipitation. Once you have your solutions, you need to think about how you're going to show their conductivity. The classic Nuffield technique suggests a 12-volt bulb and 1 molar sulfuric acid. Even then, the bulb's going to be pretty dim. I'm going to suggest some alternatives, because while I recognize the idea was to use an AC supply to minimize electrolysis, it really doesn't have that much of a huge effect on this demonstration. It's also a lot of stuff to set up. The CLEEP's conductivity indicator is remarkably sensitive, and there's not a huge amount of gas production when you consider the volumes that we're going to be working with. If you want to be quantitative, then you can use a multimeter on resistance mode. You'll probably get values in the tens of kiloohms for this demo, but a scale switch is sometimes needed mid-demonstration. There are cheap pen-style conductivity probes available online for under a tenner. These are sometimes sold as water testers, and I've chosen concentrations here for the demonstration that we're going to do in the final version to let any of the above cheap options work, because the 10 microsiemen per centimeter resolution is plenty for this demo, as well as the one that we're going to do next time. If you have a little bit more room in the budget though, a data logger probe with 1 microsiemen per centimeter resolution is a worthy investment, as you can produce a graph on screen to analyze. And take all of the concentrations describing here, divide by 10, and you'll get even better results, with solutions that are even safer to handle, easier to dispose of, and behave in a more ideal way without the ions getting in each other's way. Whatever you decide to use, demonstrating the conductivity of the solutions, as we did earlier, is a great opportunity to adjust your meter settings so you don't get a false start because your sensor is set up incorrectly, like happened here. Now, anyone who's generated a pH curve by opening a burette over a pH probe in solution will be tempted to just do the same thing as they always do for that with this demo. I know I was when I first trialed it. So let's take a look at what you get if you run the experiment in lazy mode. I've got 25 centimeter cubed of 0.1 molar sulfuric acid here, and I'm about to empty 50 centimeter cubed of barium hydroxide into it of the same concentration. In theory, we'll see the conductivity drop as we progress to a minimum at the equivalence point, and then it will increase on the other side again. The conductivity probe gets dimmer and brighter the way that we'd like, but you can see that the graph can be a bit of a mess. Incidentally, if you have more precise kit, that tenfold dilution will largely fix this issue for you as well. We do get a broadly V-shaped graph the way that we would like, but notice the way it curves. Some students might already be able to suggest what's going on here. We're diluting the solution so that at the end point, the ion concentration has actually dropped threefold. This isn't a problem when we generate pH curves because the logarithmic nature compresses out most of the dilution. The other thing that you might notice is the minimum lagging after the addition of the equimolar quantity of reactants. Indeed, here we saw actually the graph was a real mess before we got to that point. This can be because poor mixing, and also it takes a few moments for the precipitation to complete. It would be better perhaps if we had more volume for us to play around with. If you're using some electrodes, you'll also notice that they get submerged to a different level as well. So, let's see if we can get the demo working a little bit better. This time, we're going to run the tap a little slower, and we're going to begin by adding some water to the acid. It doesn't matter how much, as we still have the same number of moles reacting this way. I'm going to go for a tenfold dilution, so let's top it up to around 250 centimeter cubed. We also get bonus points for being able to get the probe fully into solution and a comparatively small rise in the level of the liquid. This hugely reduces graphing artifacts like we saw before. Just look at that beauty. We still get a bit of a stretch from the dilution, but now the slowing tap on the burette as the liquid runs out is the major issue. Before we talk about a final improvement, let's briefly discuss order of addition. Some people right now are going to be watching this and weeping as I put alkali into the burette. It really doesn't matter though. There are advantages and disadvantages whichever way you do it. I've chosen to do it this way to fall into line with the demo that I'm doing next time as well. And at higher concentrations, you might actually get some precipitate in the burette, but with a 0.1 molar hydroxide that I've been using here, I've never seen any tap or jet blockages. By having the hydroxide in the burette, you avoid stirring in a load of atmospheric CO2 or any CO2 that's already dissolved in your deionized water at the start. And if you add in the opposite direction, you do benefit from having all of the barium precipitated out. So if you do it this way, it is worthwhile adding a little bit more acid before filtering off the solid for disposal. So it swings and roundabouts, really. Most demos would finish here. There is a wealth of detail revealed in the shape of this graph, but of course you can go further and plot against volume instead of plotting against time. This is going to be more of a practical than a demo because of the time constraints, but just look at the beautiful curve that you can get. By applying a volume correction factor, this gets even nicer. It's at this point that I'll remind you all of these values were collected with my speedy dissolution method mentioned before. Boiling deionized water and guard tubes are overkill for this reaction. BDIs will have spotted the curvature around the equivalence point associated with solubility effects. And perhaps more interesting, the gradients aren't identical on either side of the equivalence point. But this is where I have to leave you on a cliffhanger. In each column, I only get 700 words to play with, and this script is nearly three times that length already. So tune in next time to have your minds blown by how much detail we can see in the curves produced from the neutralization of strong and of weak acids.